If you've ever shopped for a wireless microphone system, you know that there are many different options. It can be very confusing and could leave you feeling discouraged or could potentially lead you to choosing the wrong system for your situation. In this video, I'm focusing on the differences between analog and digital wireless systems. And by the end, you'll feel confident about which one is right for you. Thanks to Guitar Center and Sennheiser for sponsoring this video and supporting audio education. I'll be using some Sennheiser wireless systems to demonstrate the points in this video, but the information I'll share with you can be applied no matter which wireless system you're using. If you think one of these Sennheiser systems might be the right fit for you, use the link in the description below the video to learn more. First, let's look at the core components of an analog wireless handheld microphone. Inside a wireless handheld transmitter like this one, you'll find the microphone element itself and a preamplifier that boosts the analog audio signal up to a usable level. Then that analog signal is sent to the transmitter, which modulates a much higher frequency carrier signal that can be broadcast wirelessly. This might be hard to imagine if you're not an RF engineer, and I know this because I am not an RF engineer. But luckily, all you need for the purposes of using wireless microphones is a general understanding. And I found an animation on the internet that might help you understand this a little better. The top waveform is the carrier, and the waveform below that is the audio signal itself. As you can see, the carrier has a higher frequency than the audio signal that's being transmitted wirelessly. In practice, the difference in frequency is much greater than this illustration might have you believe. Audio signals range from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, while wireless microphones often operate in the UHF, or the ultra high frequency range, between approximately 470 to 698 megahertz. But that wavelength difference would be difficult to represent on an animation like this one. Plus, they're traveling through different media. The sound wave is traveling through air, whereas the RF signal is traveling through the ether. So we're just going to use our imagination on this one. What I want you to notice is that in AM, amplitude modulation, the amplitude of the carrier is modulated by the audio signal. Meanwhile, in FM, frequency modulation, the frequency of the carrier is modulated by the audio signal. Getting back to our wireless microphone, after the transmitter modulates the signal using frequency modulation, the modulated carrier is sent to the antenna for broadcast. It's important to recognize that the frequency of the carrier will modulate in an FM system. While you might choose 432 megahertz on your device, the actual frequency of the wireless broadcast will modulate within a window of frequencies. On the other end, there is a receiver which receives the modulated carrier, converts it back into an audio signal, and sends it to your mixer, your camera, or whatever audio device you're using. The signal flow can also work in the reverse in the case of IEMs, or in-ear monitoring systems. Instead of a microphone on stage transmitting to a receiver by the console, you could have a transmitter by the console that's driven with a monitor mix. And that transmitter could transmit to a belt pack receiver on stage, which powers a musician's headphones. This is a simplified version of how analog wireless audio works, and digital is similar on a fundamental level, but there are some key differences. One key difference is that in a digital system, the signal from the preamplifier is quantized into a digital audio signal, and that digital signal is what modulates the carrier. So, while an analog wireless audio system will have a modulated RF carrier, which might vary in amplitude and frequency in accordance with the audio signal that's being transmitted, a digital system will have a modulated RF carrier, which will represent ones and zeros. And as you'll see in a moment, this small change opens the door to much more flexibility and greater sound quality compared to analog systems. Now that we understand the basic principles behind wireless audio, let's explore the key differences between analog and digital wireless and which one makes the most sense in your situation. I mentioned before that the frequency of the carrier will be modulated within a limited window of frequencies, and the bandwidth available impacts the dynamic range of the audio signal being transmitted. In analog wireless transmission, this requires the use of a compander that compresses the dynamic range of the audio going into the system and expands the dynamic range on the other end. Digital wireless systems do not require a compander. One of the biggest implications of this difference is that you'll have a much more natural and accurate reproduction of the original audio signal with a digital wireless system than you might expect from an analog wireless system. The effect of the compander will be more or less apparent depending on the source material. With a source like speech, you wouldn't likely hear much a difference at all. However, sources like electric guitar and bass with more low frequency and more high frequency content, and sources with more dynamic range may lead to more audible differences. Now, I don't want to scare you away from all analog wireless systems. Right now, you're hearing me through this analog wireless transmitter, and now you're hearing me through this digital wireless transmitter. And both of them provide adequate sound quality, especially for spoken word. Plus, these are currently loaded with two different capsules. On the analog version, we've got the E825, and on the digital, we've got the E835. So any difference you're hearing is probably subtle, and it may in fact be due to the difference in capsule rather than the difference in wireless technology. And the audibility of these differences will also vary from situation to situation. For example, live reinforcement at a noisy concert versus capturing audio in a controlled environment for recording or broadcast. In terms of sound quality, digital is certainly the winner here, as it often is. However, both can provide adequate results for many situations. I can't reiterate this enough. Many professional shows employ analog wireless microphone systems without any issues, and this has been the case for decades. Along with sound quality, I think it's also worth mentioning latency here. Analog wireless systems will have virtually zero latency, while digital systems will exhibit a small amount. Now, by itself, the amount of latency you'd expect to hear from a digital wireless audio system would be so low that it wouldn't be noticeable. I only mention it because if you already have a digital console that adds some latency and some other stages throughout the signal chain that add additional latency, it's worth considering the cumulative latency and how digital wireless systems might add to it. This could be important for IEM systems where the musician wants to hear as low latency as possible, but even there, we're talking about milliseconds of difference. So latency goes as a win for analog, but it's so close that I don't even consider it an issue in the vast majority of situations. Another important factor to consider when choosing between the various types of analog and digital wireless systems is the reliability of the system and the number of channels that it can facilitate. We already know that the modulated carrier in an analog system encodes the analog audio signal, and that the modulated carrier in a digital system encodes the digital audio signal as ones and zeros. But this simple difference has some big implications. First, it results in a different outcome when the signal quality is degraded. Digital wireless systems will exhibit little to no degradation of quality up until the point where it simply stops working, resulting in a dropout of audio. Meanwhile, an analog wireless system will exhibit gradual degradation of audio quality with static, noise, pops, etc. I've got a full video that I produced with Sennheiser on how dropouts work and how to set up a system to reduce the chances of dropouts or signal degradation. You can find that video linked in the description below. Right now you're hearing me through an analog wireless system. So as I get further and further away from the antenna, you may start to hear some noise. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So right now you're hearing me with a digital wireless system. That means that eventually this will just cut out when I'm counting. 1, 2, 3. Both systems are capable of covering a wide range if the antenna configuration is set up properly. And that range can be extended using different antenna technologies and RF distribution tools, like amplifiers, splitters, and combiners. But beyond what happens when the transmitter is out of range, or when the system is configured incorrectly, say with two transmitters using the same frequency, there are even bigger differences when it comes to channel count between analog and digital systems. Well, actually, it depends on the type of digital system you're using. There are digital wireless audio systems that operate in the 2.4 gigahertz band, which is unregulated. These systems are used primarily in corporate conferencing environments or in more entry-level systems like this Sennheiser XSW Digital. I like using the XSW Digital system because it automatically finds usable frequencies, and it's just super convenient anytime I want to send an XLR signal without a cable. So the 2.4 gigahertz based digital wireless systems are the one exception, but generally speaking, UHF, ultra high frequency digital systems, tend to facilitate more channels in the same bandwidth compared to analog systems. This is where we start getting more technical than I can fully understand, but I believe it has to do with the way the signals intermodulate with nearby channels. In an analog system, you need to take much more care which frequencies are being used, because even if the transmitters use different carrier frequencies, those carriers could interfere with one another. And my understanding is that the binary nature of digital signals makes this much less of a problem. Now, if you're a real RF engineer watching this, please correct me if I'm wrong with a comment below. But my experience tells me that digital systems can allow for many more channels within the same bandwidth compared to analog. And that's a big deal, especially as the wireless frequency spectrum becomes more and more limited over time with legislation in different regions. Each of these systems that I use in my system can automatically scan for open frequencies, both the analog and the digital systems. And I only need a few open channels, so this is easy to manage using the controls on the front panel of the receivers. However, if you're working on a big festival stage or on Broadway, the number of wireless channels becomes a lot more demanding, and you may start to see the benefit of fitting more channels into the spectral range that's available. In cases where you have several wireless channels operating at once, that's when deployment and monitoring software can be helpful, which is accessible for both analog and digital systems, depending on the model you choose. New digital technologies, like WMass, which Sennheiser has played a huge role in developing, allow for even more channels than ever before, which is much needed in these times where, again, the spectrum reserved for wireless microphones is becoming more and more limited. Now, wireless audio is a pretty technical topic, but there are many similarities to audio signal flow and acoustics, so if you want to learn more about how these systems work, remember to check out that video I mentioned earlier that I made with a Sennheiser engineer. He does a much better job of explaining the technical elements than I could, and you can find that video in the show notes. If you want to learn more about some of the other challenges we face as audio engineers and the tools that have been developed to overcome those challenges, check out the video that's on your screen now. I'll see you there.